the motto of Ndondori Secondary School, and today we are joined by Simon and Pauline. So Pauline, when did the school begin?
Our school began in the 80s.
Okay, and what is the name of our principal?
She is called Lawless Dairo.
Okay, and is the school a boarding school or is it a day school? Is it mixed?
It is mixed, consisting of girls who are in boarding section, and there are some who are day scholars, and we have also boys, of course. Generally, all boys are day scholars.
Okay, and today we are talking about the power of the cross. We are sure this topic will bless you also. Join us as we join the other students in the service, learning more about the power of the cross.
Yesu kama Mesiya, Mesiya damu yako, Yesu kama Bye. Bwana Yesu asifiwe sana. One thing I want to say, maybe before we delve into this topic of today, is that as Jesus was making his journey from Gethsemane, you know, all of us know that the agony of Jesus started in a place we call Gethsemane. And I want to say that journey wasn't easy. It wasn't simple. At Gethsemane, this is where Jesus, you know, wept. He wept, pleading with God, "Father, take away this cup from me." He was telling God, "I am not able to bear this. It was too painful." He was seeing it coming. But he surrendered it to God to decide. He told the Father, "But let your will be done." And of course, that was the night they were coming for him. Judas Iscariot, if you are to read before the portion before the one we read in Matthew, you know, he came and kissed Jesus, you know, showing those who are coming for him, this is the right person, after taking money, of course. And I want to say, the journey that Jesus started from Gethsemane all the way to Pilate, all the way to Herod, it wasn't easy. It was a journey of being mocked. It was a journey of being flogged, of being whipped. And Jesus went through a lot of pain. And I want to say, it wasn't a walk in the park. It wasn't something easy. It wasn't something that, you know, any person would want to go through. Matthew, Jesus did not have any sin. He was not guilty in any way. He had done nothing. I want to say he was not the first one to go through that. Of course, you know, sources say more than 30,000 people had gone through crucifixion in the time of Jesus, but because of their mistakes, these would be crucified, murderers, and people who are doing all the funny things, all the bad things in the society of those days. People would be taken through crucifixion. What was the need of crucifying this Savior? This person who, wherever he went, he did good. Ladies and gentlemen, he did it for one purpose. Of course, Jesus would have stayed longer. He had only done those things for 3 years. He would have stayed longer. He would have stayed longer and continued raising more men from death. He would have stayed longer and continue making many deaf to hear. He would have stayed longer and continue feeding people with bread. He would have stayed longer, giving hope to the orphan, giving hope to the widow, giving hope to those who are discouraged. He would have stayed longer to make the lepers, you know, recover from their leprosy, to make them whole, to heal many, and to do the many things he did. He would have stayed longer, and more weddings would have been done, and they would have been more beautiful, like the wedding of the Cana of Galilee, where the wine was depleted, but he turned water into wine. He would have stayed longer. But he was not here to stay any longer. He was not here on earth to continue hovering around. He had only come to identify with us. He had come to identify with our pains, with our problems, and with our situation, and with our circumstances. And despite the fact that Jesus was clean, so clean, he was so white as snow. He was righteous and holy. He had never even dared take somebody's property. But that day, they decided, "We are going to crucify him together with the thieves." Praise the name of the living God. Bwana Yesu asifiwe sana. What am I driving at? I want simply to tell us, Jesus had to go through all that because of one purpose. And one thing I know, our Lord Jesus, actually, he never worked with multitudes. He never worked with multitudes. You all remember him going to call Peter, "Come follow me." He was calling individuals. Him meeting a tax collector and, of course, deciding to pay a visit to him. He was dealing with individuals. You all remember he met a lady who had, of course, been an outcast in the society because of her behavior and conduct. She was a prostitute. But Jesus forgave her sins and brought hope to her. Jesus was dealing with individuals. Praise the name of the living God. You can tell your friend, Jesus was dealing with individuals.
Jesus was dealing with individuals.
You can tell her again or him.
Jesus was dealing with individuals.
That is it. And therefore, when Jesus was making all this journey from girls and money, a journey of torture, a journey of pain. He had one person in mind. He had one person in mind, and that is you. Praise the name of the living God. Amen. Jesus had you in mind. Jesus had you in mind, and that is why he accepted to suffer. He did not commit any crime, but he accepted to go to the cross just because of you. Praise the name of the living God. And today, we are here because he died. We are saved because he died. We are here because this message of the cross, it is power that brings salvation to those who accept this message. Praise the name of the living God. I want to say, from Matthew, we've seen a few. I want to go through the events that we meet in Matthew. We've seen something unique that happened when Jesus was on the cross. Number one, there was darkness over the land. When Jesus was on the cross, there was darkness over the land. That's what we've been told. And I want to say, darkness is a sign of judgment. In Egypt, you all know, Moses commanded 10 plagues. You know the number 9? Which was the number 9? It was darkness all over the land, is it? And number 10, the death of all firstborn. That one shows, you know, darkness is a sign of judgment. It precedes judgment. And therefore, there was a lot of darkness over the land. And I want to say, Jesus took all our judgment. He took all our sins, and now he was being punished so that we may be set free. Praise the name of the living God. He went, there was a lot of darkness before he gave up his spirit because of me and you. He carried our judgment. He carried our sin. He put all of them upon himself so that we may be saved. Number two, he did something. He cried, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And I want to say Jesus cried. He's cried. He was crying because of us. When he was crying, "Why have you forsaken me?" He was crying because of me and you. He was crying so that we may not be forsaken, so that we may be remembered, so that our troubles, our problems may be sorted out. I want to say that is why God says, "I will never leave you, I will never forsake you." Because Jesus already cried for you. "Why have you forsaken me?" Jesus cried, and that cry reached the Father. And the Father, as we see in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 13, verse 5 to 6. Can we read that one to confirm? That is Hebrews 13, verse 5 to 6. My scripture tells me that yes, let's read it. This is what my scripture tells me. "Let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have. For he himself has said, 'I will never leave you nor forsake you.' So we may boldly say, 'The Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can a man do to me?'" Praise the name of the living God. God has made that promise that he will never leave you. He will never leave you and he will never forsake you. Because already Jesus cried for you. He cried for you on the cross. He cried for you so that you may always be remembered. And I want to say, even if men on earth will reject you, even if men on earth will leave you, our God in heaven cares so much about you. When he remembers the cry of Jesus on the cross, he remembers, "I have a daughter to be concerned about. I have a son in Dundori High School to be concerned about. I will never forsake that one. I will never leave that one." I want to say somewhere else in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 49, verse 15 to 16, the Bible tells us, "Can a mother, a weaning mother, a nursing mother, leave her own child?" Yes, even if she can do so. "Personally, I will never leave you." God has promised he will never leave you. For sure, your mother at home at time may reject you. Your father at home may fail to cater for your needs. Your brothers and sisters, a time will come and they will rise against you. It will happen, even in your own class, even in your own village where you come from. Those things will happen. But we have a promise from the Father. Because already Jesus on the cross cried for us, he will never leave us.
Going on a short break.